Thanks.
Things are good. Thanks. Nice to be with you
today. Yeah, you as well. You as well. And look, as somebody who hosts the pregame show for the Hornets, I'm a part of pretty much every single broadcast, and I'm there all the time. I'm excited to see what you do with the place. But just generally speaking, how's the transition gone? What is on your plate right now as the new co-owner of the Hornets?
Well, we have a lot on our plate. We obviously are working really hard to, one, figure out how we're going to get this arena renovation underway, and working with the city on that and with contractors on that. And it's a big project for us and really important. And we're starting to lay out our plans and work with the city on our practice facility, which we feel is essential for the long-term success of the team. And so we're working on those two things as it relates to major projects. And in terms of minor projects, we're just getting ourselves familiar with the management team, familiar with our basketball ops team, introducing ourselves around. And we had a chance to do that last week. And we're familiarizing ourselves with all the strengths and weaknesses of our organization so that we can impact it in a positive way.
Rick, ordinarily I would have been at the press conference last week, but I was on vacation. I hate I missed it, so I'm going to try to avoid redundancy in these questions, but there are a lot of things I would like to ask you. Just in terms of Charlotte as a market, it's a not growing city is underselling it. I mean, this place is bursting at the seams. There's opportunity all over the place. You know that probably better than anybody. But when you said last week that you want to repay Michael Jordan with a championship, a lot of folks reflexively said, yeah, okay, this is Charlotte we're talking about here. Now, we want it, Rick. We'd like to see it. But, it feels like a baby steps type of thing here with the Hornets, as we've not even won a seven-game playoff series, since the turn of the millennium. How do you go about winning a championship in a place like this with an organization like this where it is at this point in history?
Well, look, I think first of all, on the city, this is a sleeping giant. Not viewed as the top city that it really is. And the opportunity to build something in Charlotte, in the state of North Carolina, which is really the mecca of basketball. And so the city's great. It's growing. It's young. It's vibrant. It loves its sports. It loves its basketball. And so it's a great place to be able to do this. I think players would love to be in Charlotte. And so it's an attractive place for a lot of reasons. It's got great weather, growing population, new business. And so we're thrilled about the city. In terms of building a championship, I think you're right. It's going to take time. Our view is that what we need to do is build a great organization, invest in our people, and have a strategy. And that strategy is to be competitive year in, year out. And to do that, we've got to draft the right kinds of players, and we've got to develop those players. And having a team, hopefully, that's going to be full of high character kids and kids that want to work and get better and be part of a culture that's going to be great. And, I've been part of a winning culture and a winning teams for many years of my life. And I'm on a winning team now. It's not in sports, but it's in the business world. And it takes the same formula. It's about the culture. It's about the people we have. And it's about creating a sustainable plan to win. And, obviously we don't expect it would be great to win this year. We don't expect to win it all this year. I think we expect to be competitive. We have some really good young pieces, though, Kyle, that I think we can build on. And, having just awarded $200 million to LaMelo Ball, we obviously believe that he is a cornerstone piece of a successful franchise, or we would not have done that. And, we have around LaMelo, obviously, the second pick, and we're really excited about who Brandon is and what he can become. And in addition to those two guys, we have a number of really good, young, talented players, and we have some vets. And so what we're trying to do is build a team that can win down the road. Is it 2 years from now, 5 years from now, 7 years from now? I don't know. But I do know that we will build an organization that is striving to win, that is organized in a way to win, that is consistent in its approach to team building. And, having been around the league now in a pretty intimate way for 8 years, I feel pretty confident that we can do it. You put the right people in place. You know, winning it all is really hard, and I do hope that I can repay Michael with the championship and we can repay him with the championship, but only one of 30 gets to win every year. But there's no reason why you can't build a team that is competitive year in, year out. And if you do that and you do it in the right way, I think we will absolutely have a chance to compete for a championship.
Rick Schnall, co-owner Charlotte Hornets. He's with us on the Body Works Plus guest hotline. I want to throw the name Gabe Plotkin out there as well for anybody else who, you know, is unfamiliar. He and Rick Schnall, of course, will spearhead the charge and the effort to bring a title to Charlotte moving forward. Now, a lot of my listeners, Rick, and you and I will have conversations into the future, I'm sure. I hope we do. But a lot of folks are curious about your involvement in personnel decisions, both leading into the draft and free agency, given, you know, obviously this was happening in the background, you know, be it the somewhat controversial decision to bring Miles Bridges back, or even, you know, the decision to draft Brandon Miller. Some believe that there was some controversy there. How involved were you and Gabe Plotkin? How much were your voices heard? And are you satisfied with the decisions that were made overall?
Yes, we were in the background because the deal wasn't closed. So ultimately the decision was made by Mitch Kupchak and Michael. But we were advised on, as Mitch has said, we were advised on what was going on. And, you know, I did attend the draft, but we did leave the decision in the draft to our basketball operations group. And so Mitch made that decision. We, of course, did support it based on the limited knowledge that we had without all the benefit of all the work that had been done leading up to that. And we are happy with that decision. You know, we also did consult on Miles. You know, Miles obviously made a big, enormous mistake. He's a convicted felon. But we did listen closely to all the work that was done and all the background work and to what our basketball ops believes about Miles. And we do believe in second chances. And we think with Miles, what we have is a one-year contract. And, you know, what I like about Miles is he wanted to bet on himself. He wanted to take a one-year contract because he felt strongly and believed in himself and believed that he will have a great year. And, you know, time will tell. Miles obviously is an enormously talented kid. I've had a chance to spend a very short period of time with Miles. And I think Miles understands the situation that he's in, appreciates the situation he's in. And I do support the decision that we made as a front office. And we'll see how it goes from here.
I know you got a busy day, so I'll let you go on this. And again, we'll catch up in the future. But when it became clear that you and Gabe were going to be the guys leading the charge moving forward, and I got to hear more about Rick Schnall and your background, I got a lot of friends in college basketball, Rick, who knew your name immediately, and they said you could hoop a little bit. And you know, I found out that, you know, you've been to a lot of fantasy camps, Coach K, Jim Boeheim, Jim Larinaga, and that's part of your thing. And that excited me, Rick, when I heard that, because it seems to me that you're a guy that has a real passion for the game of basketball. Can you talk about that for my listeners and, you know, why the fantasy camps were such a big part of your life these last several years and, you know, what that means for you as an owner? What should they know?
I appreciate that question. Listen, I'm a basketball guy. I've played all my life.